So today I wanted to discuss a few spotters with you of how things will be presented to you in FRCS Part 3. Because since you guys are becoming seniors now, I think we need to think of things in those directions. Like, if at all you are given a case in FRCS Part 3, how does the case present and how do you go about it? Okay? So we'll try to develop your skills of recognizing and presenting your case and thinking on the go basically, so that you don't get scared. Can everybody see an image that I have sent in the master's group? So, Alia, do you want to have a go at it?
Sir, for the spotter, do you want me to describe the whole picture or just the diagnosis?
Actually, why don't you start with the diagnosis? What do you think it is? And then I will start asking you questions.
Sir, I think it is a toxo scar.
It's a toxo scar. That's what you think. Okay. No, it's not.
I agree. I think.
It's not. Vivin?
It's a scar
into
some toxic
retinopathy. No. No, it's not either of that.
Is it iron? It's a foreign body, sir?
Yes. It's a foreign body. It's an intraocular foreign body. What sort of symptoms would you expect to be there earlier?
In this patient, sir?
Yeah.
Like, he would give a history of trauma.
Definitely, that's the first thing you need to figure out.
Then there would be an entry wound. He would say that something has gone inside my eye.
Great job.
And I don't think so, I have removed it. He has a foreign body sensation. Apart from that, there might be reaction like he will have visual disturbances, because a foreign body that big would have an adverse reaction in the whole eye.
Okay. So what
like
you seem to
AC
be doing
will
is,
not be quiet.
Okay. What you seem to be doing is, you seem to be answering the signs along with the symptoms together. So for example, things like AC not being quiet, and an angry eye, all those things would be more of your clinical examination part. Like, what would the signs be seen on a slit lamp? Apart from that, some basic symptoms that you told, there will be a history of trauma. You told there will be pain and there will be some visual acuity disturbance and something to do with the eye. The patient will be in severe discomfort, maybe in pain as well. Why not? That is the most simple way. The reason you need to think about symptoms before you think about signs is because when a vignette is given to you along with an image, they talk about the symptoms. They never tell that a patient with an entry wound, with 3 mm gaping, with an intraorbital, they will never tell that. They will tell you the vague symptoms and they will give you an image which looks like something else. It will never be a clear-cut image with a big nail sticking out of the eye. They will play games like this. They will give you an image that is not so readily recognizable, and they will move you towards toxo scar. And I was generous enough of telling you, no, it is not a toxo scar. Whereas the FRCS Glasgow 3 protocol is, they can either guide you or they can either let you be on your own. They have both the choices. Sometimes some of the examiners, they do yes. Okay? What else? Otherwise, sometimes they are required to guide you. So you never know what can happen. your thing is, if you're not sure about it, just say you're not sure about it, so that some hint can be given to you. Okay, having said that, what are some of the signs? I think Alia has covered. Alia, do you want to elaborate on the signs once again? Some signs that you would like to see while you're doing the clinical examination.
Sir, there would be an entry wound.
Okay.
Entry wound which could be either through the lids or through the sclera.
Mm-hmm.
That would be there.
Okay.
And then the conjunctiva would be like injected, congestion would be there.
Agreed.
The cornea may or may not appear clear based on the entry wound. If suppose the entry wound is in the cornea, there would be infiltration. Or there would be a circumcorneal congestion with new vascularization around the wound.
Yeah.
Then AC would be AC would not be clear. There would be AC reaction with AC cells present. Then iris, if the foreign body has gone through the iris, there would be hyphema and there would be iris bleed. Then the pupil might be mid-dilated, and then finally lens particle, there would be a cataract if it is a long-standing wound where the patient has not come, and if it's an early stage, there would be some kind of disturbance in the lens and the capsule, and anterior vitreous, some kind of vitritis might be there, can be seen based on the kind and nature of the intraocular foreign body. And ultimately in the retina, we would see the foreign body. It could be lying on the retina or it could be entangled within the vitreous.
Great. So what was good about your answer is, you went systematically from the start to the all the way to the posterior segment. Not only does it look good to the examiner, but also it makes things easy on your brain as well, because you know what topics you have covered and what you have not covered. One thing you probably missed is you have not spoken about an iridodialysis. Or an iris tear, which you could have also mentioned.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Okay.
Apart from that, I think you mentioned traumatic cataract, which generally people forget. They forget to talk about the lenticular involvement in this thing. And vitritis, I would not exactly expert in this. And then you mentioned another condition, stating depending on the foreign body, I would expect a vitritis or not. That was a good management. At this point, I would like to ask, adding to Alia's point, Fevin, would you like to comment a little bit on the types of foreign bodies that might enter the eye, or is there a classification for the types of foreign bodies? Some foreign bodies you might need to worry about, some you might not need to worry about. Anything in that regard?
It's a metallic foreign body. If it could enter the eye at a high speed,
okay.
It could be probably a sterile foreign
body. Probably a sterile foreign body.
Yeah, due to the high speed of impact, and it's a metallic body that has penetrated the eye at a high speed, the chances of infection are less.
Chances of infection are less. That's an interesting point. I never thought about that. So you're talking about a projectile that can enter the orbit. Agreed. Anything else? Any other classification? Or I classify them like this. Can you help me out? There are some poorly tolerated foreign bodies, some fairly tolerated foreign bodies, and well tolerated. Okay. What do you think? Which foreign body falls into which category? Can you name a few poorly tolerated? Can you hazard a guess?
Iron particles.
Okay, why did you say that? Because iron.
Be a surrounding reaction.
Yes, because iron tends to react with the organic tissue inside the eye. For that matter, I would actually put iron under a fairly tolerated foreign body. Whereas, I would put top of the list any sort of organic foreign body. The first thing you need to worry about is any sort of organic foreign body, specifically like a plant or a vegetative material. you have to just mention that. Secondly, you are always talking about a chemical. You have to talk about a chemical foreign body as well. Because it is our imagination that we always tend to think about metallic foreign bodies the moment you think about a intraorbital foreign body. But the reality is there are other types of foreign bodies as well. And they will want to hear you mention that you will also be thinking about a vegetative matter or a chemical. Another metallic foreign body that you mentioned, iron was fairly tolerated, but I agree there is some reaction to iron. Is there any other metallic foreign body that you will be particularly worried about?
Lead.
Yeah, Fabian, do you want to answer? Yeah, so Alia gave an interesting answer. Lead. I never thought about lead actually. Because does lead have like poisoning done in like big quantities, or does it have like a particulate poisoning? Because normally kya hota hai ki when we have it in like micro quantities, that is where it enters the cells and then it causes some damage, I think so. But the current
most are like factories, some metal factories will be there now, especially
yeah.
Smelting processes.
Yeah.
In smelting processes, they're like, I just read in news.
Yeah, no, I read about mercury and lead poisoning all the time. But I'm actually figuring out, because normally speaking, intraorbital foreign bodies, we don't talk about lead a lot. And I'm actually interested why they don't talk about it, because lead is poisonous. But the answer I was looking for is, what you need to tell is copper.
Okay.
So copper is one of the highest disseminating things that can enter the eye for some reason, and they are highly retinotoxic. Okay. So there are two things going for copper. One thing is it is more disseminating than iron. Second thing is it is retinotoxic. So it is a directly correlated thing to our eye. But just find out about lead. Okay. I'm actually intrigued about lead, but a little bit later. Some other types of foreign bodies could also be glass, plastic, iron, even lead, aluminium, steel, other things also.
Tons.
And if it's surprisingly, I think lead is well tolerated. Okay, maybe it is having issues when there are small quantities. But either way, copper should be our number one answer, along with organic matters like wood and other vegetative matter, and what is then chemicals. Okay, having said this, are there any investigations you would like to do in this, Alia?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
I would like to go for an MRI scan to see the extent MRI.
Okay, so first, and the first thing Alia has, falling into the biggest trap of intraocular foreign body. Okay, why is it a big trap, Alia?
Sir?
Why is it a trap? Why am I calling this MRI answer a trap?
No, it was a slip of tongue, sir. Actually, I meant cans. MRI is magnetic. If it's an iron foreign body, the eye will
obviously
be gone.
Obviously. And imagine if I told you that the iron body, the foreign body inside the eye is not metallic. Okay?
Huh.
Will you still go for MRI?
No.
No, you will not go for MRI. Why? Give me two reasons.
Two reasons.
No. One, it is expensive. One, it is expensive. Why would you want to send the guy for a 30,000 rupees test when there is a CT scan available for 5,000 rupees?
CT. I wanted to say CT scan, sir.
Okay, no problem. No, let's make mistakes in this class, okay? So first thing, the second thing is, even if I would have told you that the foreign body is not metallic, who is the one who's giving you this information? The attendant. Or let's say the patient. Can you trust the patient's mental state of mind at that point of time? And imagine if usko metallic foreign body maybe. The unknown status of the foreign body should itself, you know, ring alarm bells in your head that I do not want to mess with MRI with this guy even the least bit. Okay? So the first thing I would actually argue is CT would not be a bad answer. Okay? But
B scan.
B scan, I was actually getting to that. I was about to say say what is the first best test and what is the first non-invasive
test?
X-ray. Yeah, X-ray also can be very easily done. But I think CT is actually like hitting two birds with one stone. It is doing the fine resolution of an MRI along with the easiness of a X-ray. It's slightly costly, but I think uske aank mein foreign body gaya hai. Like he's gonna be okay if you charge him a little bit of money. So what CT will you ask for? So I'll make life very easy for you guys, okay? Ophthalmology, man. In ophthalmology, it's always CT, brain and orbit, axial and coronal, 1 mm fine cut sections. I know it's a mouthful, but when you're talking about the orbit specifically, this is what needs to come out of your mouth. The same thing is for some intraorbital fractures as well, or if it's a TED, if it's a thyroid eye disease with a compressive optic neuropathy near the orbital apex, if the muscles are actually causing a compressive etiology to the optic nerve, you have to still go for a CT brain orbit, 1 mm cut sections, axial and coronal planes. Okay. Okay. Any other tests would you like to do? So somebody mentioned B scan. So B scan would be a good answer. Having not found anything on CT. Otherwise CT will be more than enough, because right now you are talking about an FRCS part 3. FRCS part 3 people like to be in the real world. For example, these people, if you ask them about myasthenia gravis, you can tell them that single fiber EMG is a very very good test and the most sensitive test, the most confirmatory test. But they will expect your brain to be telling you in the class that I would actually do an ice pack test as a first test, not a single fiber EMG. These people stay in the real world. They try to get the answers out of your mouth as if the patient is in front of you. You would not do a single fiber EMG. Who are we kidding? You would actually do an ice pack test. You would actually do a 30 minute rest test if it's a myasthenia gravis. That is the kind of answers they want in FRCS part 3. And I am taking my merry time, I am taking my jolly time in this class with you. I have spent already 25 minutes, 10 minutes waiting for you guys, and 15 minutes with the class itself. But in the real world, in FRCS 3, you have 4 to 6 minutes on each case. So you have to be direct, concise, succinct and to the point with your answers. You cannot dilly-dally here and there. Don't tell long stories, as is appreciated in an Indian setting. Tend to be to the point, tuck tuck tuck. These tests, this is the reason. Okay? Fine. Any other test you would like to do? Okay, a B scan, you have to mention, I would like to do a gentle B scan only if it has been warranted with a inconclusive CT. Okay?
Sorry, sir.
I
didn't get
it. You have to tell that I would like to go for a gentle B scan.
Gentle
B scan only after it has been warranted due to an inconclusive CT.
Okay.
Otherwise, you know what would happen most, in reality what would happen is, the guy with this thing going inside his eye will not come to ophthalmology. He will go to A&E, accidents and emergencies first, or what do you call them here?
Casualty.
He goes casualty. Casualty mein his CT is already done. So it is your job when the patient complains of an intraocular foreign body to already ask, has any report been done, okay? So with that report, you can actually stop wasting the patient's time and your time as well. So most of the patients are going to come to you with a CT already done. But still, you should know that CT is supposed to be done in this patient rather than an MRI, which is like a common trap. Another thing, any other things you would like to get done? So you guys are missing a very important test at this point of time.
Sir, do we have to know whether it's an open wound?
How would you know that?
Seidel's test.
Seidel's test, okay? So never forget a Seidel's, no matter where the injury is. Go for a Seidel. It's as non-invasive as a CT and it's as cheap as 2 rupees. Probably I don't even know one staining thing cost. It's just like an ice pack test. Mention Seidel's. So I hope everybody knows what a Seidel's is, right? Okay. Anything else? So, Alia mentioned entry wound earlier. any particular test you could carry out pertaining to an entry wound, anything clicks your mind or something like that?
Staining.
Staining is already done. You've done a SIDLs. SIDLs will perform a staining as well as a leakage or anything like that.
Retro illumination. If
Gonioscoping. Actually not for the entry wound, but gonioscopy is a good answer. Gonioscopy can also be done. So you would also like to mention a gentle gonioscopy, okay? But can I just guide you towards something else? Before you do a gonioscopy, why are you doing gonioscopy? Why would you do a gonioscopy?
To rule out whether the foreign body is there in the angles.
Yes, I mean, it could be the answer. There has been foreign body inside the angle. I wouldn't say it's a wrong answer, but mainly you're trying to see whether the angle has collapsed. You want to mainly see whether the angle is open or no. Whether has it been a traumatic angle recession or something like that. So before you do a gonioscopy, is there anything that will take, that will give you a clue that yes, the angle has collapsed? Again, always try to say in the FRCS, try to be non-invasive. Practical, real world, what you would do. So you would ask the patient to get an IOP check with an NCT.
IOP.
A high pressure would immediately indicate, yes, there is some angle abnormality involved. Then you would like to mention a gentle gonioscopy. Okay, because at this point you are manipulating the intraocular contents. When you are pushing for a B-scan, when you are pushing for a gonioscopy, there has to be a very good reason why you are putting the patient through that. Whereas SIDLs, nobody is going to bother. NCT, everybody is going to be okay, fine. Okay? What else? So regarding the entry wound. So imagine it has been your 2 to 3 day old foreign body. And the patient is coming to you a little bit later. And the wound has started to discharge. There is some discharge coming out of the bone. Would you like to do something? So you would perform a culture. Okay. The discharge that is happening through the wound, it's not every day that it happens, but you are supposed to mention that if the foreign body has indeed come out, or sometimes the foreign body is protruding out, which is later on taken out, I would like to culture the foreign body. Okay? So at this point of time, I will ask you, how will you perform the culture? What would you do?
Swab.
Okay. Calcium alginate swabs. In what? In what media? Brain heart infusion. You don't need to tell all this. It's not necessary. You know why it's not necessary? Because you're not concerned with the cornea at this point of time. If it was a cornea case, okay, I would actually go deep into the cornea scraping technique, all those things. But at this point of time, I think we are okay if you mention these 6 points. You need to mention there are 2 smears. What are they?
Two? Sir, I didn't get you.
There are 2 smears and 4 cultures.
Yes.
What are they?
KOH, gram plus gram negative.
And gram staining. Okay?
Gram staining. Yes, sir.
So you definitely go for a KOH mount and you order for a gram staining done. Yes? Then what are
the
4 cultures that are essential for ophthalmology? If you ever have any culture to done, these 6 things have to be said. Two smears and 4 cultures. What are they?
Brain heart is one. Brain heart infusion.
Brain heart is very specific. It's very advanced. Again, you have to talk about FRCS 3. They are very
practical. Blood agar.
Yes, blood agar.
Then LJ.
No.
I
would not go LJ because LJ will be more to do with TB. Or if it's like a TB pathology, I would maybe bother with LJ. But LJ doesn't come under the essential 4 cultures. What are the 4 essential?
Brain heart
Filling is
nutrient overlay agar is there, no sir?
No. Filling is sitting with
no.
Solik sir. He must have seen sir order four cultures. So the four cultures are blood agar, chocolate agar, sabur hearts, and what else? Maybe thioglycolate medium, you can say this. Now why did it mention thioglycolate specifically? Because all these are aerobic cultures. Okay, these three cultures are aerobic cultures. The stain is not a culture. The stain is just to give you some immediate direction of what to do next with the patient's treatment. Should you go the fungal hyphae route by giving natamycin and amphotericin or voriconazole, or should you go the bacterial route by giving fortified antibiotics, vancomycin, all those things. The KOH mount and the gram stain will give you the initial direction. But you have to mention three cultures, blood agar, chocolate agar and sabor arts. Sabor arts is for the fungi and blood are for the more the gram negative organisms. Now the other ones, the thioglycolate medium you are supposed to mention because otherwise you will miss any anaerobic culture. There is no other anaerobic culture in this. You cannot miss anaerobic culture because sometimes in cases like endophthalmitis, is there anything that grows on anaerobic culture in endophthalmitis?
That
lactose
fermentis are there, no sir? I don't remember that color is there. That color will be there. They will become pink in color.
Are you talking about Pseudomonas?
Pseudomonas, sir. No, these lactose fermenters and non-lactose fermenters are there. In that agar, no, along with nutrient medium, they will add phenolphthalein. I forgot the name of the agar.
I feel like I'm revising microbiology. No, the most important thing you need to be worried about when I talk about endophthalmitis specifically is, what is the organism that causes delayed onset endophthalmitis? There is only one. There is only one, you have to know this. It is Propionibacterium acnes. Okay. That is generally what you are worried about when you are talking about an intraocular foreign body or any endophthalmitis for that matter. And that is only grows on an anaerobic culture. So if you do not mention the thioglycolate medium, you will be caught by that day. What if it would have been an anaerobic organism? Would you want to miss it? Is that how they ask the question? They will never really, you know, go to this microbiology division with you. They'll just give you a vague question and they'll move on to the next one. So you'd like to do four cultures, okay? Now one more important thing. I think we all missed it. Another non-invasive test we could have done. A very important test. In fact, I'm surprised how I forgot it. And none of you mentioned it so far. Fabian, what is the most important thing that the eye does?
Extraocular movements.
No, that's not the most important thing.
Visual equity.
Yeah, visual equity. Okay. So you have to take
that's
the
that I told.
No, I'm talking
starting
about,
Mitch.
No, I'm not talking about visual equity. You have to measure visual equity, obviously. For medical legal.
Color vision.
Why did you say color vision?
Color vision.
Yeah, Fabian, you said something?
Macular functions.
So you said macular functions. Alia said color vision. Are you think this is the right sequence you're going for? I mean, visual acuity was very nice. From visual acuity directly you want to jump to color vision and macular functions. What is the middle thing that you're not? So you would do a pupil examination. Okay?
Okay.
You would like to first look at how the pupil is doing. Is it an RAPD? Is this guy having a traumatic optic neuropathy? Is this guy's optic nerve working or no? I mean, you can also argue that at this point of time, we also get to know it with the visual acuity itself. But I would actually say, why not do a pupillary examination? It's so non-invasive. It's so easy. You have to rule out an RAPD in this case. Okay? So rule out an RAPD. Then what Alia said, I would agree with. Color vision is also another way. Then, Fabian said macular function tests. What do you mean macular function, like visual acuity or what? What do you mean? Because your visual acuity will be taking care of most of the things as far as macula is concerned. If you would like to get an OCT done later on to look at if there is a macular edema, that is not a point of priority right now in the initial testing time. Okay? And anyways, I don't know to what degree OCT will even help us at this point. Okay, so any other test you would like to do? You can come behind. Okay, fine. So these are the kind of investigations that they will be expecting of you. So you need to be a little bit faster than this. How we are going very relaxed today. I wanted to discuss 5 cases with you, but we are still stuck in the first case itself. So then what would you do? Okay, Alia mentioned another answer. Extraocular muscles. Extraocular motility. Extraocular motility is also extremely important. Okay? Extraocular motility. What are you looking for when you're talking about extraocular motility?
Any restriction of movements,
okay,
if
fine.
The foreign body has gone and affected any muscles.
Okay.
Like
yes, you're looking for a restrictive strabismus, agreed? How would you confirm this restrictive strabismus? Any test you would like to do?
Ocular motility test.
Okay, ocular motility test.
Patient will look here and there.
Okay. If you still have time and if it warrants it, later on when all the priority things have been taken care of, after CT and everything, if you have not found anything, you can also do a forced reduction test. If there is indeed restrictive strabismus,
mm-hmm.
to find out whether the nature of the restriction is paralytic or a muscle capture. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Fine. What would you do now? How would you manage this patient? How would you treat this guy?
Sir, like after a diagnosis of intraocular foreign body is made.
Yeah.
So, I'll say, sir, you tell whether
it's
the site or not.
Yeah. Yeah,
like, we would involve a vitreoretinal surgeon.
Very good.
If the foreign body is intraocular and the foreign body is lying over the retina, then I would ask a vitreoretinal surgeon for his intervention.
Mm-hmm.
Probably he will do a pars plana vitrectomy. And then if there is any associated like retinal detachment or something like that, then he would fix that and then take out this intraocular foreign body, probably using magnets, if it is a magnetic one like iron. Otherwise, he will just like lift it off the retina and then inject proper injections like intraocular antibiotics for a prophylactic treatment.
Hmm.
That is what I have seen, sir. That's it.
Hmm. Okay. So you could start by saying that I would like to admit the patient, first and foremost. Secondly,
yes.
Would you ever try to attempt removing the foreign body yourself on the street now?
Like, according to my, I don't think it would be safe on my part to do that.
Okay, imagine.
I can try using a bag, like, but it wouldn't be safe. Because it would need a aseptic precautions have to be taken.
You can take reasonable aseptic precautions in the strip time. I mean, it can be. The thing is, the question is, you are never supposed to do it if you have not opted the CT first. But if you have opted the CT, the foreign body is large enough, okay, and the foreign body is anterior segment enough that you can actually take it out. So you can do it. But you should be ready with all the consequences that happen after it. Okay? So mostly you would perform it in the OT, would be a better answer. But it can be done. I mean, there are protocols where it is said that it can be done on the slit lamp as well, provided it is large enough and it is anterior enough. The arguments for not doing it is because it might cause an extreme hypotony, or it might cause a CSF leak or other things like that. Okay, it might cause unstoppable bleeding and other things like that. And regarding vitrectomy, it's not so straightforward regarding vitrectomy. But if it's inside the retina, then definitely you have to do a vitrectomy. If it's all the way in the posterior segment, then you have to do a vitrectomy. Otherwise, if it's in the anterior segment, in the angle, you can just go in and take it off, right? Why I'm saying that is because Shaji sir has done this. He tried taking out a foreign body in the slit lamp. It was an angle foreign body. Then he was not successful. Then he went to the OT and took it out with the help of a spatula. That case got very famous. He presented it on E10 or AI over this. So there are possibilities about regarding surgical exploration. This could be the thing. Now, what would you give these people? What medications would you give?
Prophylactic antibiotics.
Who is this? It's you? Your voice
changed. Only I am the girl over here.
Yeah, I thought you just sounded like earlier. Babita, sorry. So you would give prophylactic antibiotics? No. You need to go
NSAID.
You need to go IV. You need to go
IV only.
You need to go, what do you call this? Fortified antibodies. So what fortified antibodies would you start with?
Cefazolin 45.
Why not cefazolin?
I don't know.
Why not start with cefazolin and then go for cefazolin once he gets better?
Broad spec link.
So the thing is, if it's extremely severe, you always start with cefazolin. After the patient has recovered reasonably, then you go for a cefazolin. Okay? So in your case, you wouldn't be wrong saying a cefazolin as well. But depending on the patient's severity. Having given him that for a few days, then you would put him on oral antibiotics. The oral antibiotics are to be continued whether the foreign body has been extracted or not for a period of 14 days. It will be like an augmentin. Along with some NSAIDs for pain and other stuff. Also, you can give the patient an anti-emetic. Why? Why do you think?
Because of the antibiotics we are giving him.
No. You give him an antibiotic because the eye is soft right now. Any sort of vomiting or nausea or any intra-abdominal thoracic pressure increasing can cause pressure to develop on the eye itself and can get the intraorbital contents to come up. So you give them an anti-emetic, okay? What else? I think this is more than enough. You give them antibiotics IV, you give them oral antibiotics for 14 days, then you give a patient anti-emetics, pain medications, NSAIDs, anti-inflammatory tablets. I think that should be more than enough as a management, as a broad management, and you would involve a vitreoretinal surgeon is a key point. You would never not do it without their involvement. Okay. check your
it's on the speaker of the left eye showing.
Blood supply to the
macula.
I wanted you to fall for that trap. Why did you say that? What is the diagnosis? It looks like a this is a tricky image. Okay, the reason why he is struggling is because I wanted him to struggle. He could have given me two diagnoses, actually one diagnosis. First of all, do you see anything in the macula over there, anything particular that you want to comment over? Bevin? So why did you say that the disc is not receiving any blood supply? Because the disc is pale? Disc is not visible actually. Yeah, I agree with you. Disc is not visible. Okay, anything else? Something that is staring you in the face. What is in the center of the image? Okay, correct me if I'm wrong, okay? Is it a cherry red spot? It's a cherry red spot. Okay?
So, you have a bad picture for that?
Huh?
That's a bad picture, cherry red spot.
Okay. Agreed. It might be a bad picture. But it is a cherry red spot. Okay? What next? Would you like to say something else? Would you like to comment on something else? So where does your brain go when you think of cherry red spot? What did you say, Anya?
Berlin's edema.
Why did you say Berlin's edema for cherry red spot?
Trauma.
Why not CRAO?
You could say that also. No sir, because no. I will tell you. There was a cherry red spot.
Yeah.
Surrounding that, the like the color of the retina is kind of hyperemic. My brain did not go to cherry red spot in the first place. My brain went to CSR. Because
yeah,
I thought that much area was edematous.
Yeah.
That's why Berlin's edema was the first thing that struck my mind. Because
but I will
thinking that way.
I will counteract your point by saying there is boggy edema in CRAO as well.
But my brain did not go over there.
Why?
Because Berlin's edema has edema in it, that's why.
And what about boggy edema that you see in CRAO?
But I'm telling you,
that's an
edema.
No, you are right. You are exactly right. This is a trap question. That's a cherry red spot, but that's not a cherry red spot for CRAO. The reason why Fevind was struggling so much probably was because he saw perfectly patent arteries and veins nicely pumping blood, but how come the cherry red spot is correlating to this so-called CRO. It's not a CRO. It is indeed a Burley's edema or a commotio retinae. And Alia was right, there would be a history of trauma in this patient. Okay. Having caught you in this stage, I would ask Kevin. Like, it's obvious that chelated spot would be seen in CRO. What other conditions would you suspect this? For example, what I want you to tell me is, you're looking at a chelated spot. What would be your differential diagnosis? Or where other do you also see a chelated spot? It's an MBBS question. Yeah, commercial retina, yes. Agreed, because this is the commercial retina case. What else? Let's see if Akhil knows the answer. He's a fresh MBBS student. So you have some conditions like
Tay-Sachs,
I think galactose-serviceitis deficiency, sphingomyelinase, I think they were
yes.
also
this all metabolic storage diseases
yes.
will be having this
steroid spot. Okay, so one of the things is they can in the viva. I think they can maybe ask for the different causes of chelated spot apart from CRO, but it is highly unlikely that they will keep a chelated spot that is not CRO. Okay? I wanted your brain immediately to give the answer of CRO and get trapped. When Fabin told that there is significant loss of blood supply to the macula, I thought he is falling into that one. But then he is smartly backtracked. So that is why I was smiling. Either way, this chelated spot is not a CRO. Now, imagine if it was a CRO. Or, I am sending you another photograph. Just have a look at it.
Looks like a CRO, sir.
Yeah.
Because the arteries have, like, the patency of the arteries are quite less. And then we have this pattern, I think that is called.
What it is called?
I don't know. Nail trap pattern. No, nail trap pattern is something else.
I think you are confusing with snail trap degeneration. I think you are trying to say segmentation of the arteries.
Sir?
Yeah, I think you're trying to say segmentation of the arterioles.
Yes, segmentation,
okay.
Yes, sir.
And then you said something like snail trap. I think you're trying to tell
no,
something to do with rail track like that. What is the name of that?
Huh?
What is the name of that? That is box carrying. Box
carrying, yes.
Box carrying of the arterioles. Okay, so I hope you are happy with this image. This is a good image for chelated spot. This is a good enough image for chelated spot body to you. Is it disturbing?
Yes, sir.
Now, please. Fabin, what would be your diagnosis for this? There is not
the previous picture.
No, no, the one that I just sent you, the last one.
There is
no trick here. It's a straightforward thing.
Nice, sir. There's no picture.
No, no, no. The one that you were telling segmentation and all those things.
earthquake you said, that's a CRA.
It's a CRA, okay? No doubt about it, it's a CRA. So could you please just tell me the salient features? Can you tell me the symptoms with which the patient may present to you with a CRA? One big symptom, most important.
We have sudden loss of vision.
So it will be painful. Painful, sudden loss of bilateral vision.
Unilateral.
It has to be unilateral. It has to be painless. Okay? Then you have sudden loss of vision. Because if you just say sudden loss of vision, the guy will start asking you what is the other differential diagnosis for all loss of sudden losses of vision. Then you have to go painless, then you have to go painful. Okay? So you have to say unilateral, sudden, painless vision loss. Okay, can you tell me some of the main signs that you will be looking at in CRO? Or can you describe the image? Sorry, I can't hear you, Fabian. Fabian, I can't hear you, buddy. Can you speak a little bit louder?
Probably his visual acuity would be reduced to only cortic fibers or less.
Yeah, it would be reduced to cortic fibers, yes, exactly. Okay, what else? What are the main things that you can see in the image which will help you diagnose? So you have to mention a candidate spot. You have to mention a pale retina with boggy edema. A boggy edematous retina, that is pale. Okay? And you have to tell some other signs would be segmentation of arterioles, box scarring, what else? Retinal arteriolar attenuation. What is Hollinghurst plaque?
Sir?
Hollinghurst plaque.
This is a calcium plaque. Like, usually happens in atherosclerotic plaque, which goes at the junction of this arterioles.
Is it a calcium plaque or atherosclerotic plaque?
Atherosclerotic, not calcium.
It's an atherosclerotic plaque, okay? So it's an emboli, an atherosclerotic emboli that you can very clearly see in the image. It is generally lodged at the bifurcation of just the entry of the central retinal artery, and it becomes true, that is where it gets lodged, okay? So at this point of time, you might be asked, what types of emboli do you know?
Pathology emboli or
ophthalmic emboli? Any emboli. Whatever you remember.
Then there is solid emboli, then there is gas emboli.
Okay.
In solid emboli, you have thrombus which has disseminated thrombus.
Okay, we don't have
then
that much
we
time.
Have
basically, we'll be in like a 4-minute viva state. So you'll be saying a thrombus? Yes, agreed. What else?
Thrombus, the calcium plaques will
okay,
be there, atherosclerotic
yes,
plaques will be there.
Atherosclerotic
emboli. After that, air embolus might be there.
You already told gas. Okay, fine.
Yes.
Air embolus. Atherosclerotic emboli.
Amniotic.
amniotic fluid emboli. And what else?
Saddle emboli, that is.
Sorry?
Pulmonary.
Saddle emboli.
Huh. Pulmonary artery. He's saying
pulmonary embolism. Pulmonary embolism. Okay, fine. There is also fat embolism.
Yes, sir. Fat embolism.
Particularly after gynecological surgery. The patient is prone to fat embolism. Okay, fine. But the guy who's coming to us most probably might not be. Gynec patient who's come post gynec. He's like a 55 plus year old. So what is the most, three most common emboli seen in CRM? So what could be the causes? Fabian, what could be the causes for this guy? Why do you think he's having a CRM? So major causes are emboli, four of them. When, like I told you, thrombus. It can be a platelet fibrin clot emboli, it can be atherosclerotic emboli, it can be a calcium emboli. Okay, emboli, 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 four emboli. After that, what else?
Other systemic diseases that can cause myomas.
I can't hear you, buddy. What?
Other systemic causes.
Something systemic you are saying. What systemic causes? I can't hear you, buddy. Non-invasive test. by doing a simple ESR test. And also you can ask the patient, depending on his age, if he's more than 55 years of age, whether he's having any scatteredness, jaw claudication, all the same things. You will not answer with a temporal artery biopsy because it is invasive. You will not want to go there right now because we are talking about CRAO. And GCA is a rare cause. But you have to mention that you would definitely try to rule out GCA.
Okay.
Now, imagine if the patient is young, 35 years of age. What would you do? What investigations would you do?
Gender.
Any gender. Okay, let's say female.
No, if she is a female, then if there is a history of OCPs, then there would be a higher incidence of CRAO.
Agree. Good point. What else?
Then, autoimmune diseases.
Okay. Any specific
like,
autoimmune disease? Factor 5 Leiden.
Sir?
Factor 5 Leiden. Okay, fine. What else?
Connective tissue disorders. Ehlers-Danlos, Marfan's.
Marfan's?
Ehlers-Danlos.
Ehlers-Danlos for CRAO. Like, let's keep it simple. Let's say autoimmune is right, but CRAO mostly is associated with systemic lupus erythematosus. Okay? SLE. What test would you do, Fevin, for an SLE? Like how Alia was saying. After having done this,
yeah,
you would also go for an ECG. You would also perform an ECG. Because people with CRAO generally have emboli moving in their bodies, and that emboli can cause a myocardial infarction. Okay? To confirm the diagnosis, you can also go for a FFA. But it is hardly necessary. How would you treat this guy? So two things. Time is of the essence. Within 2 hours, any treatment will have any chance. Second thing is, there is no definitive treatment. All treatment is based on anecdotal evidence. Okay? All treatment is based on anecdotal evidence, and the first 2 hours is very, very important. You have to mention this. What would you do in this first 2 hours? You would perform an ocular digital massage, first thing. Secondly, you would try to use a fundus contact lens and try to put a pressure and do a massage with that. What is the wisdom behind this?
To
dislodge the emboli, which hardly ever works, but still you would try. Also, some people advise hyperventilating in a paper bag. Why do you think that is?
Because
increase the respiration rate.
So,
because so if there is hypercapnia,
yeah,
then the vessels will dilate.
Very good. So you are trying to induce a vasodilation due to a hypercapnic state. That should be your answer, okay? If it is asked. So these are all anecdotal things. None of these things work. The most important thing, more than treatment, is actually follow up. Would you send this patient back home, Akhil? Sorry.
No, no.
But you have to send him home sometime.
Right? Starting like 2 to 3 hours, we keep him under observation.
Yeah. Okay. Agreed. Eventually, when you have confirmed that this is a CRAO, okay, will you perform? Will you call this patient back? Is what my question is. Fabian, would you call this patient back?
Immediately it is not treated, then there is no point in calling him.
Okay, would you ever call him in his life?
A little
lower, because it's very loud. Yeah, what did you say?
I will look for symptoms in the celluloid.
Symptoms in the celluloid.
Well, call him again because I have to look for symptoms that is getting in.
Are you looking for improvement? And follow? Now, what is one thing you will be afraid of in the follow?
Yes, sir.
What is one thing you will be afraid of in the follow?
Any symptoms that he could develop in the
celluloid? Actually, the most important thing you have to say, mention in follow-up, is you would like to call the guy after 1 month to look for neovascularization of the angle of the iris or the disc and of the retina. Neovascularization happens in 2 out of 10 CRAO patients. Okay, and if it does indeed happen, you will perform a PRP. That is the thing you have to tell them. Okay. So I think let's call it a day. We discussed 2 cases. Next class we'll discuss more. Okay, and we'll keep this this trend going on of discussing cases, and this way you will be more, you know, well versed with actually discussing and coming across with solutions and challenges. Because what happens in the textbook is hardly what is supposed to be answered in the real world. And FRCS Part 3 is all about how you deal with the patient practically in a more financially responsible and non-invasive manner. Okay? Okay, guys.
Is it retina the whole process or?
No, it will be random. Okay. It will be random. Like, I'll be talking about spotters, maybe a cornea spotter. Maybe orbit spotter, like that. It could be thyroid as well, anything it can. Mainly what I'm trying to do is, there are 70 cases, 55 to 70 cases, that are very, very important in terms of your spotters and viva. If we tackle these 70 cases, you guys will be good to go. You will have a good enough grasp of all the important 70 cases, okay? We might have GCA in that, we might have thyroid eye disease in that. Okay, guys, all the best. Take care. Bye. Thank you.
I have to shout so much.
Yeah, I think the caution interference is very cool.
What I need to do is, I need to.
Microphone.
Suggest me a good microphone.
The one thing I have never bought in my life.
Okay.
So
then in that case I need to buy a proper YouTuber microphone.
Yeah.
So that way I can actually take YouTube videos.